On behalf of the session and the congregation of Eastminster, welcome to this place of worship. On behalf of the family, welcome to this service of worship. Our being here is what makes going through this both possible and celebrating. So let us worship God. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Our opening hymn is number 39, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Let us pray. O God, who gave us birth, you are ever more ready to hear than we are to pray. You know our needs before we ask and our ignorance in asking. So show us now your grace that as we face the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Speak to us once more your solemn message of life and death. Help us to live as those who are prepared to die, and when our days here are ended, enable us to die as those who go forth to live, so that living or dying, our life may be in Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Who needs to introduce Vicki, but I'm going to anyway. Vicki Cook, daughter, and it's good to have you here to share, because we've come to share from a family perspective what we have celebrated in Stella's life.
Thanks, Harry.
Good afternoon. Thank you all for being here to honor my mother's life. I so wish my brother was standing right here beside me. Some of you have heard me say how I had prepared this eulogy 10 years ago. You know, I'm a planner. So most of these thoughts were already prepared, and thank goodness, because you know that with my mind today, many things would have been forgotten in many names. You've probably already read about my mother's family from your bulletin. However, I'm going to start with some of the saints of her family tree that have gone before her. Stella Marie Smithy Cook Post passed away on Wednesday, May 10th, 2023, at the age of 100. Mother was born November 29th, 1922, to Lucille Damewood Smithy and Robert Smithy in Wiregrass Community, Texas. She was preceded in death by her parents, two brothers, Robert Jr. and Loy Ray, known as Cotton, one sister, Aline Pickard Smithy, two husbands, J.D., we called him Jack Cook Jr., and Harold Guyton Post, her son, John Keith Cook, and her daughter-in-law, Christy Louise Sanderlin Cook. Mother came to Dallas in 1941 following graduation from Quinlan High School. Early days in Dallas were enjoyed by playing basketball with a women's semi-professional basketball team known as the Dallas Hornets. She attended Rutherford's Business School, and after several employers, she found a home at Wicker Fish and Poultry Company, which later became known as Cisco, a name we all know. Retirement as a bookkeeper came in 1984 after 33 years of service. In 1951, Mother married Jack Cook, and she had two children. I was the oldest. My brother was born 2 years and 5 months later. She was devoted to her family, to her career, and to cleaning. I knew y'all would all get that. Growing up, she liked the housekeeping and her sister liked the cooking. Mother has been teased her whole life about cleaning. Once, Uncle Johnny told Denise, "You can either be like your Aunt Stella or fill in the name." She was known to stand in the kitchen sink to clean the garden window. And recently, as recent as the last few years, she's been scolded by me and caregivers for liquid golding the panel and for cleaning the oven. Juana, where are you? You know what made her the happiest was having the garage mopped. Mother was active in Eastern Star, where she held many offices and was honored with a 50-year membership. She also served as mother advisor for Rainbow Girls. And I have to say, I thank my Rainbow Girls, if you'll raise your hands, I see you. Thank you. Thank you for being here today. Together, the Cooks worshiped at St. Mark and West Shore Presbyterian churches. Following my dad's death in 1975, Mother became quite involved in competition dancing, ballroom dancing. This seems like the place to introduce a nickname Mother had, but not known to many. Rachel reminded me of this name. Stella Starlight, and I think some of y'all can see that. One of my friends, Jim Hines, labeled her with this moniker, and those of us who knew her well agreed that Jim was spot on. Dancing led her to Harold Post, and they were married in 1983. The following year, they joined First Baptist Church of Dallas, where Mother served 2 years as president of the women's Bible class and was an active leader in their Sunday school. Mother and Harold worked together in local chapters of AARP, National Association of Retired Federal Employees, and the Sunset Community Annual Reunions, which is the area where she grew up near Greenville, Texas. She was also a member of the Echo Book Club, which met at Northwood Club, and she held several offices for that social group. Now, talking about the book club, while visiting with the Wrestling folks last week, Rachel and Brian and I were reminiscing looking at the picture book from her 90th birthday. And one conversation led to another one, but a funny one that Rachel told me, which I never heard, was she asked her, after learning about this membership, well, Granny, what book are you reading? Mother said, oh, honey, we don't read the books. however, in later years, she read quite a few books on a Kindle, which a friend at work gave her, and I said she would never use. We later had to update that Kindle because she did enjoy reading on it. Now, back to the Echo Book Club. Another thing that is a funny memory, she volunteered to create the table decorations for their bi-monthly meetings. Now, Mother had many talents, but arts and crafts was not her forte. So my dear friend Marcia Kay and I, we were the ones that created and had such a fun time for many, many months doing that. But we both told her, please do not accept this job again. Now, despite their busy schedules, Mother and Harold found time to exercise. For example, hanging from a bar in the garage, which is still there. They also enjoyed cooking together. Harold was the artist, and really Mother improved her skills with his help. But now if you eat, you're gonna have to exercise. But they restricted their calories. One night Denise called and asked what they were having for dinner. What did they have?
Fritos and cheese.
So if that's a diet that kept them looking as good as those two looked. They also, Mother and Harold spent fun years traveling, gardening, playing 42 with many church friends. Visiting with their 7 grandchildren was a joy. Occasionally, they even enjoyed their combined 5 children. They loved their children, but oh, those grandchildren, they were the greatest. Miss Adeline was born after Harold had passed away, and how she has entertained Aunt Mother for several years now. Adeline's 5. Rachel traveled with Mother and Harold, and she credits them with a tradition that she and Brian have created with their boys of traveling to the national parks to honor her and Harold and also to celebrate their birthdays every year. Harold and Mother moved their membership to Eastminster Presbyterian Church in later years, where Mother participated in Sunday school, women's circle studies, seniors day out, soul food ministry, and many other activities with wonderful new friends. She loved sending cards, calling the membership for congregational care and cooking for others. Survivors include me, her granddaughter Rachel, and her husband Brian Merritt, and great-grandsons Jacob Wayne and Jack Dalton, her brother Rayford F. Smithy, Uncle Pug to most of us, and generations of nieces and nephews. Harold's children and their families were especially dear to my mother, and they continue their care all these years in loving and sweet relationships. They are Kay Post and Preston LePage, Tony LePage, who has passed away, and Jan Post, and Marilyn and Max Post. Grandchildren are Sherilyn and Jim LePage, and their children, Zachary, Kevin, and Kara, Greg and his son, Preston, Gregory, LePage, Mandy, and Jason Post, and children, Emma, Zoe, Ruby, and Wyatt, Julie Post, and Stephen Arxer, Allison Post, and Catherine Post, and Josh McMillan, and daughter, Adeline Ray. Now, here comes the hard part. So many people make up a person's life, And I would just like to thank every one of you who have cared and loved my dear mother for so many years. She loved you all. I always found it touching how everyone, the owners of the cleaners, the people at Albertsons, the car wash guy, my friends at work, everybody asked about my mother for years. What a blessing to have a mother that was so admired for her genes and her tenacity to make it to be 100 years old. And she did it so gracefully. I'm well aware of the hole I'm getting ready to dig right now when you try to thank individuals at a time like this. But be assured, everyone in this sanctuary could be named. However, some just have to be mentioned for a span of 10 years of cards, calls, visits, food, taxi service from family, friends, neighbors, and caregivers. Mother would expect me to mention Ann Lindbergh, Bobby Brown, Eli Alvarado, Kathy Mann, the Frias family, Mina Williams, Vicki and Louis Thibault, Denise and Tony Bennett, the Post families, Judy Smith, the Gleaners Sunday School class, many, many folks from Home Helpers, Scott, Will, Veronica, Maria, Norma, Sherry, Dorinda, Suzette, and Kenda. Thank you. To Rachel, Brian, Sharon, a huge thank you. A huge thank you. You know all that you have done for and continue to do for Mother and me. Our family thanks Harry and all of Eastminster who have gone out of their way to make this service a wonderful celebration. For my friends Elaine, Vicki Gale, Truly, Sue, and Marcia Kate, and again for all of my Eastminster family who helped set up and prepare for this service and the reception I hope you enjoy afterwards. Thank you. Our family appreciates the comfort of everyone's presence today honoring Mother's life and what a life it has been. As Terry Tosh mentioned, can you even imagine all the changes in our world that she witnessed and enjoyed in her 100 years? Amen. And I couldn't say this.
Okay, I was Aunt Stella's favorite. I got to ice the cake.
Tell them.
I got to ice a cake at our inner kitchen when I was six, which was not a common occurrence.
Exactly.
I'm honored that you asked me to do this. This is, the 10-year plan did not hold up on this. There was a poem originally, but Vicki thought that the Mother's Day card that she bought for Aunt Stella recently would be more fitting for today. For my mother, you taught me so much, how to live my own life, make my own decisions, and choose my own paths to follow. But I want you to know that even with all this experience and perspective, I'll always need my mother. I love you. Happy Mother's Day.
Thank you, Laura.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Eternal God, your love for us is everlasting. You alone can turn the shadow of death into the brightness of the morning light. So help us to turn to you with believing hearts. In the stillness of this hour, speak to us of eternal things, so that hearing the promises in Scripture, we may have hope and be lifted above our distress into the peace of your presence. For this we pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. A reading from the book of Isaiah. Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my victorious right hand. For I, the Lord your God, hold your right hand. It is I who say to you, do not fear. I will help you. So ends the reading of the Old Testament. And let us join together responsibly as we share together Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes to the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand.
The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night.
The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life.
The Lord will keep your going out and coming in, from this time on and forevermore.
Then we turn to the New Testament. And we turn to the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation, and about the last chapter. And we read these words. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, see, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away. And the one who is seated on the throne said, see, I am making all things new. Also he said, write this, for these words are trustworthy and true. I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb. And the city has no need of sun or moon to shine upon it. For the glory of God is its light, and its lamp is the Lamb. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it. Its gates will never be shut by day, and there will be no night there. So ends the reading of the epistle. And then the gospel comes from the 14th chapter of John. Let us stand as we hear the gospel reading. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go and prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And Thomas said, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to him,
I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. I have said these things to you while I'm still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. So peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you, not as the world gives. So do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. The good news, the gospel of the Lord, the word of the Lord. Please be seated.
Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Let not your heart be troubled. His tender word I hear, and resting on his goodness, I lose my doubts and fears. Though by the path he leadeth, but one step I may see, his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. Whenever I am tempted, whenever clouds arise, when song gives place to sighing, when hope within me dies, I draw the closer to him. From care he sets me free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For his eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me.
The other day, some words appeared in someone's post on Facebook. Anyone who knows me also know that they had to be at the very beginning of the daily string of posts, because I rarely get beyond the one that appears on top. These words had apparently just been discovered by the writer, and they were these:
the light of God surrounds me. The love of God enfolds me. The power of God protects me. The presence of God watches over me. Wherever I am, God is. I'd heard those words before. One day at Texas Tech, I was walking across the campus with the dean of men, a Presbyterian with what one might call a resolute temperament. I'm not sure what we were discussing, but he pulled out a well-worn card from his wallet, and he handed it to me, and he said, "This is what keeps me going." And those were the words on the card. They offer a glimmer of confidence and hope and peace, even at some of life's hardest times. And it seems to me that they are the words that appeal to us right now. We started this service singing, "Great is thy faithfulness." We've remembered the words of the prophet Isaiah, "Do not fear, for I am with you. I will strengthen you. I will help you." We've shared the words of the psalmist, "The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore." We've looked into eternity with the writer of Revelation. The home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. God himself will be with them. We've heard our Lord's assurance at that fateful Last Supper, "If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also." In other words, wherever I am, God is. Stella walked this earth, as we've heard, for a few months, over a century. The Bible says that our years are given are 70, or by reason of strength, 80. Well, what does it say about somebody that added 20 to that? Think about it. Whatever your age and whatever condition you might be in right now, Stella lived to say, "Oh, if I could just be your age again." God was with Stella in her coming in and in her long journey and now in her going out. If we must turn her loose, then we need that sense of confidence. And when we come to this time and we stare out into eternity, I don't know about you, but I need that confidence. And I really suspect you do too. You see, eternity is beyond our experience. It's beyond our comprehension. The Bible writers tried to get a handle on it, but their imaginings may not speak to everybody. I once attended a Sunday evening service with a fraternity brother in the church in which he had grown up over in Fort Worth. We had just sung a rousing rendition of "When We All Get to Heaven." As we sat back down, he turned and he whispered to me and he said, "I don't like songs like that." And I asked him, "Well, why not?" And he said, "Because it sounds dull. There's no basketball." So we all have our preconceptions and our visions and our dreams. And as I think about eternity, I have to tell you, I don't know what's out there, but I know who's out there. And because of the God that we have known through Jesus Christ, I think we can believe this image. God will be with them. He'll wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. And after just looking at the news last night and this morning, and we look at around with a nation filled with lawlessness and political intrigue and the caprice of the weather at home and war and rumors of wars abroad, then that glimmer of confidence and hope and peace like that, basketball or no, can give us courage maybe to turn Stella loose. We do this as an act of faith. Dr. Martin Luther King once said, faith is stepping out on the staircase when you can't actually see the stair. And how much of our lives are lived just that way? I find myself learning abstract truths through life experiences. My primary systematic theology professor called that looking at life theologically. Well, I don't know about that, but I'm glad Jesus told all those parables because it helps somebody like me to get it. I found just such an insight through one of those life experiences last fall. I was invited to a family wedding in Dripping Springs. Dripping Springs, those used to be sleepy places to the west and the south. But Austin has grown and expanded, just like the Metroplex. A lot of people have moved there. And this area in the hill country used to be mostly large ranches. Developers have brought part or all of some of those ranches, and they've turned them into suburban settlements of houses to so the masses have a place to live, those who have moved to the Austin area. And they are accessed and connected by a bunch of pig trails that go up and down and all around. Well, I was fortunate to have some good friends to stay with. They live in a community not too far from Dripping Springs. And they told me when I started down, we won't try to give you directions. Just put your address into Google Maps on your phone and it'll get you here. So it was on a Friday afternoon. I'd left a little later than I had planned, and I found myself driving into the greater Austin area. And apparently a lot of people had the same idea. Maybe there were a lot of weddings out there in the hill country. Now, Google seemed to be doing a good job. My iPhone connects to a screen on the car, and it even gives an estimated time of arrival. Well, I was driving at the speed limit, but the ETA, as I got closer and closer to the Austin area, it kept getting later and then ridiculously later. And then there's a message finally flashed up on the screen that said there's a shorter route, but it'll involve some toll roads. Well, it looked like I was going to be much later than expected, so I gave it the go-ahead. Well, I reached my destination, and just about when I planned. And when I got there, I told my friends, I don't know how I got here. I'm not sure how I came. I know I couldn't do it again. And I don't know just how I'll get home. And that was pretty much the story of the weekend. I successfully got to the rehearsal dinner, though, and then to the wedding itself, and then to the family breakfast the next day. Google always knew where I was, and it always directed me to where I was going. And back to where I started. And finally, it got me on the road heading back home. You might say that Google Maps kept my going out and my coming in. But while driving back home, I got to thinking, I wonder how Google does that. I know there's a satellite out there in space somewhere that knows just where I am, and it directs me where I'm going, but I don't know how it works. I don't know the engineers that designed it.
the workers who built it or the technicians that keep it running, but I just trust it to guide me. And then I had this insight. If I can trust Google or Waze or Garmin or TomTom or whatever to keep my going out and my coming in, then can I have any doubt or hesitation to trust my life and to place my life into the hands of the Lord God Almighty? And here today, can we doubt or hesitate to commend Stella to those same hands? Great is God's faithfulness. Wherever I am, God is. Maybe that's not enough for a party, but by faith, I believe we have enough for a celebration. Thanks be to God. We join people who for almost 1,200 years have been confessing their faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed, so let us stand and let us join them and pay particular attention to that last line. I believe in
God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
Will you pray with me? O God, before whom generations rise and pass away, we praise you for all your servants who now live eternally with you. We bless you for the great company of all those who have kept the faith, finished their race, and now rest from their labor. Especially we thank you for Stella, whose baptism is now complete in death, for all in her that was good and kind and faithful, whom you have now received into your loving presence. We thank you that for her, death is past, pain is ended, and she has entered the joy you have prepared. Help us to believe where we have not seen, trusting you to lead us through our years and bring us at last with all your saints into the joy of your home. Almighty God, Father of the whole family in heaven and on earth, stand by us in our sorrow with the peace that comes from your presence as we lean on your strength. Uphold us and help us to find comfort in the good news of life beyond life through Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. We called the sacrament of the Lord's Supper the sealing of the Word. And so we come to the sealing of the Word today, and we come to the Lord's table, and notice we said it's the Lord's table. It's not the possession of any congregation or denomination. And it is a table which is open to all. Jesus said, "Come to me, all who labor and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." So when we open it up, come to the table,
regardless of your faith or the state of that faith, but come and find rest for your souls. The communion service is on your bulletin insert. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, we praise you for your love, bringing order to chaos, breathing life into dust, leading captives into calling wandering children home, giving bread to the hungry, giving drink to the thirsty, raising the dead to life. Thank you, Lord. We thank you for Jesus, Word made flesh, light of the world, living water, shepherd of the gate, way and truth, bread of heaven, cup of salvation, resurrection and life. Take this bread and this cup, O God, a feast of grace. Take our hearts and lives praise. Spirit, come. Come and live in us, in this bread and in this cup, in your soul, one in the body, one in the blood, one with Christ, one in ministry, in this place, in every place, in this world, and in the world to come. Blessing and glory, wisdom and thanksgiving, honor and power forever and ever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, we remember our Lord's words. On the night of his betrayal and arrest, our Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks to God, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of many. Whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim our Lord's death until he comes. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. You come share them. Thank you. Let us pray. Holy God, thank you for your great love in which you feed us, strengthen and comfort us. You have given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet and renewed our hope in your everlasting reign, where there is no more mourning or crying or pain, but only joy in the company of all your saints, through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
Stella. We humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming, receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed
rest of
everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of
the saints
in life.
Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God, and of God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. And let all God's people say, Amen. Amen.